saying.
No,
I have other diseases. All of them not contagious.
Yeah. Oh, so I can touch.
Yes, you can touch. Yeah. It makes me look healthy and young all the time.
You do.
I just could you please look at Dolores when you're responding?
Oh, Dolores!
Yeah, please do the pic.
Dolores, my interviewer. Did I give you hell the other day?
Oh, you sure? You're always giving me hell.
I
That's
do.
Okay.
It's the joy of my life.
Okay, we all sort of set.
I'm set.
Now we all here have to be absolutely still like mice because Margie says.
Oh yeah, Margie.
They can laugh.
They can say
if I say something.
Yeah, but
funny.
If we bang around. It gets caught on the camera.
Oh, okay.
So we're being silent. Unless we're going to, but we will, it's informal. And
yes. We can have the legs for us.
How informal can you get?
Look
so
at
you
that.
Can start.
Shoot camera.
I can start? Okay.
You can start whenever you'd like.
Okay. All right, I'm going to start. Okay. Today, I have just a little intro. Today is June 15th, 2003. And this interview is one of a series of interviews with North Fork Women. My name is Dolores Alexander. Margie Smilo is doing our taping. Also with us today are Ann McKay, Marianne Weil, and Lisa Scott, and Takami. I can't think of Takami's last name.
I don't have a last name.
Oh, okay. All right. We're here to interview Lucille Goodman.
Lucille Field Goodman.
Okay, my description of you is this. The founding mother and a past president of the North Fork Women for Women Fund. She is also a pioneer and founder of the North Fork Lesbian Community. Lucy is our resident diva. Yes, right. A soprano, is that what you...
I am indeed.
A soprano. She started out as a cabaret singer and moved to opera. Yes, am I correct?
No, it's all wrong.
Oh, all right, well... I guess that's my idea.
You'll set me straight.
Okay. All right, but you were a professor of music at Brooklyn College.
Yes, I'm Professor Emerita.
And now Professor Emerita. That means you're retired?
I'm retired from Brooklyn
College. From Brooklyn College, yes. But you continue to teach voice to private students.
I do.
Okay, very good.
And I do master classes at CUNY Graduate Center.
Oh, very good. Okay. And Lucy lives in New Suffolk with her partner, the composer Patsy Rogers.
Quite right.
Good. Okay.
Well, let me start with the cabaret singer. I sang in order to get through high school and college. I sang at weddings, bar mitzvahs, funerals, whatever. I sang pop music, like all of us did in our teens. But I started studying classical music when I was quite young. I was very lucky to get some scholarships. And although I did some opera, I was mostly, and still am, a concert singer.
Oh. Okay.
And because I was probably the world's worst actress. I'm looking at Ann McKay now. She will verify that. I really always felt more comfortable on the concert stage. And if my voice holds out, I'm 74 now. That takes me to my 75th year. I'm going to try and do a concert for the 4th in September. It's touch and go. I'm an aging soprano, so it may disappear overnight. I'm hoping it doesn't.
You're hoping it lasts until
September?
Yeah,
I'm hoping it lasts till September, at least, right.
Yeah, that's good. All right.
So that's my my musical career. Uh-huh. The rest of it you got quite right.
Oh, good. I'm so glad. Thank you. All right. Well, then let's start with your arrival on the North Fork. I guess that would be a good place to start. Right. When did you get here?
Well,
how did you get here?
I'll try and make it brief. I came out with B. Kreloff, Marcia Storch, Marianne Dan, my then girlfriend, and we rented Edna and Pepper's cottage in East Marion on Bluff, next door to Dorothy Abbott and Marianne Weil. And it was a one-room cottage. How we all got into it and found a place to sleep was beyond me. As a matter of fact, Bea and Marcia devised a pulley so that the mattress would go up to the ceiling during the day, so we'd have room to walk around on the floor. We also made huge parties there, dance parties. We invited the whole community, which amounted to what, Anne?
Very few.
Right. Well, it was certainly 15.
Yeah. Oh,
you know, and we all squashed it. And B would cook amazing meals somehow or other in this stove that was filled with mice. And it was the best fun in the whole world. And we did that for two, three years maybe. And it was Bev Eastman who had found us the cottage and kind of was devoted to us coming out here. It must have been in
1971.
Dates and I don't get along, but it was really early. And Marianne and I were living on City Island, where Beva Eastman and Nancy Dean were living. So it all came about very naturally. And of course, we came out here, we thought we had found paradise.
Yeah,
we
but wait a minute, you're talking about Marianne. You were then with
Marianne Dan.
Yeah. Oh, that's right.
I'm sorry. Not Marianne Wilde, I regretfully say.
Okay, Marianne Dan.
Not for lack of desire. In any case, it was a different world then, and we just made the best of it, and the best was really great. So we had lots of fun. We all worked hard back in the big city, and summers were here. And then, as things happened, Marianne and I parted, and Patsy and I have been together. We've known each other since 1978. Spring of 1978, and have been together since 1980. Well, it took me 2 years to. She had scruples, which I've never had. So that's where we are, living in New Suffolk in a wonderful old house. Patsy has a big music studio where she teaches and does still compose, and I have a little corner studio of the living room and teach there and have a great time.
Yeah, and you're right.
And our community has gone from 15 to what? 500.
500, I think, is the mailing list, something like that.
Just incredible.
Yeah.
Now, I have to behave because I figured out that you're probably going to play this at my memorial service.
Oh, my. No, you don't have to behave. No, please don't behave. No, be you.
I'm going to try, because I can just see it all now. Make sure it's not in the church, whatever you do. And I don't want Margaret wearing her robes. And you all have to sit there and listen to me sing on recordings.
Okay.
That's your punishment. And if you play this, I hope Margie edits it so that it's...
No. We're not going to edit this, and we definitely do not want you to be good.
Okay. So, what would you like to know?
Well, I guess now we can move to Nookwoof, and I want you to tell that wonderful story about the Go Lightly. And
Aren't you tired of that story?
No. It has to.
I see it and hear it as though it happened yesterday, because Beva Eastman has sort of been my Jiminy Cricket for years. She is a real conscience for me. And when I forget things that are important or don't think of things that are important in the sense of our community and the world at large, she's there to give me a little nudge. Well, this nudge was by way of, you have to have a colonoscopy. That's what you have to do. It's very important. So, of course, I agreed. And there we were the night before, I guess it was January, and Beva first did, for my birthday, a tarot reading, and which she did very expertly. It was a lot of fun. And then we were out of time, and I'm still drinking this gallon of Go Lightly, and I won't describe that anymore, to prepare for the ordeal the next day. And then Beva, in her way, very seriously said to me, well, she said, if there is something that you could want or do for the lesbian community on the North Fork, what would that be? So this was, you know, big question. And after a bit and a visit to John, I said, I think it would be kind of great if we had an organization that would give grants or fund or give funds to lesbians on the North Fork who either didn't have health insurance or were underinsured or were needed non-Western intervention that there was no insurance for, that would give them some medical support so that they would not have to worry about illness, that everybody would have a mammogram and a colonoscopy,
yeah,
so that I wouldn't be here, out here alone. And she thought about it, and you know, I kind of babbled along as I am wont to do. And the next thing I know, you know, maybe 2 weeks went by. She had already thought it through. She had already, you know, organized. She had organized it in that marvelous mind of hers, and she wanted us to talk to Jan Swanson, who was in the health care field, or had been, as a nurse, a psychiatric nurse, a supervisor, a lobbyist for women's health issues, and that we would try and organize this with Jan being the leader. But the thing was that we had to interest Jan. Mm-hmm. Jan was not easy to maneuver or manipulate. I hear some chuckling. Yeah. And so we had a very serious breakfast meeting at the, what's the name of that luncheonette in Southold? Does it have a name?
That diner.
That little corner luncheonette in Southold, right next to the supermarket.
The country corner, country corner.
Yeah, well, that's
now
what
it's called,
is
now.
It's called
the
it was,
corner.
God knows what.
Oh, okay.
And the three of us sat there, and Jan was not easy to convince.
Yeah, I'm sure.
You know, was this going to be work? What was expected? How would she do it? Did we really need that? And Beva had all kinds of supportive information to say how much we really could use such an organization. And by the time we next saw Jan, she had organized the board, figured out that she was going to have board members of every age decade, geographically diversified from every point from Riverhead to Orient, and that, never mind that I had a list of names that I had thought up, she had already decided it was going to be the North Fork Women for Women Fund.
Oh, really?
Jan was the one who named it. I fought with her. I didn't want that name, and I had my name.
What was your name?
God only knows. Yeah. I kept the list. As a matter of fact, in the office, I think it's still in the office, is my big binder with every piece of paper that I ever had connected to Nuffoof. Woof. that's why I hated the name. I didn't want the name. Nuffoof, woof, woof. Anyway, it is a good name. And it is part of Jan's legacy to this community. I mean, that she gave us something that sounds more like a bark than a name. But we, you know, she really had thought it through, and obviously she was going to do it. As Beva probably knew all along that, you know, with the right bait, she'd get mm-hmm. Jan to. So Jan organized the board. She got a wonderful group of women. Should we name all the women?
If you can remember them.
Marianne will help me. Marianne, were you on the original board? Yes. Mm-hmm. Terry and
Ginny Goddard. No, Ginny Moore.
Ginny Moore. Melissa Spiro.
And you should say that, well, wait a minute, Melissa was like in her 20s. Mm-hmm. Ginny was in her
70s.
Ginny
was the oldest.
She was
in her 70s.
Yeah, she was in her 70s.
Claudia Slazek represented the 30s. I represented the 40s. Carol Marcus represented the 50s. You represented the 60s.
Yeah, and Jan.
And Jan represented
Jan represented herself. Did you mention her last name, Jan Swanson?
Oh, Janet T. Swanson. Yeah. Janet Thomas Swanson. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. So who's departed from that? Jimmy Moore and Jan Swanson. Mm-hmm. The rest of us are alive and kicking and trying to participate with the organization, each in our own way. Carol Marcus was the treasurer. Mm-hmm. Jan, of course, was the prez. I was the secretary. Oh. I'll tell you what kind of secretary I was. After Jan would read the minutes, she would say to me, "Was I at that meeting?" We had all the throes of a just-born organization, but we had a lot of fun, didn't we?
Yes.
We really didn't fight. We just disagreed on everything, practically. Our first meeting was in the parking lot of the Unitarian Universalist Church in Southold. We had been to something inside, I don't remember what it was, and we had each brought a folding chair, and we sat in the parking lot and had this meeting about having meetings about who, I think that's when we chose our officers. Mm-hmm. Carol Marcus was the only one who really had the head for numbers. And I could write, read and write. So that made me secretary. There was no VP. That was in July or June of 2002. I remember it was summer.
Yeah, June.
It was in the park.
Yeah. 92.
June of 1992. Yeah.
And I remember looking around at everybody and saying to myself, isn't this something? I mean, just look at us all here. This all happened in a few weeks. I mean, well, January was the initial conversation, but it was organized and off and running by June. Was it really mm-hmm. June? So it was delicious. It was really a good accomplishment, and everybody was into it. I mean, we believed in it, and we were going to do it.
How did the first auction benefit come about?
Well, there are pictures of that first auction, also in a photography album that was put in the office, and I don't know who has it now. It's Phyllis or Leslie or somebody. Kathleen was organizing everything. It exists. It's probably there. We wanted to do this fundraiser because we had absolutely no money. And I don't know whose idea it was to do an auction, but the board got very busy with it, and we had a lot of help. I'll never forget Dorothy Abbott standing there over a cauldron, she and Lucy over a cauldron of ears of corn, which were in season then, of course, and just, you know, endlessly cooking these corns. Connie Murray.
Where was it? Where did it take place?
Oh, it took place. I had just gotten a new investment counselor. Her name was Charlene, that's all I could remember. And she had a girlfriend whose name I can't remember. And they were renting a place out in, where was that place? It was not far from where Ronnie and Olga
had Cedar Beach?
Yeah, somewhere out there.
Yeah.
And it was great because it had a real yard and it was at the water, and It looked good, and the women, these two women, were willing to let us use it. They thought it was going to be a real South Fork event, and they were going to meet. I think they were in a very open relationship. It was so open that there were no walls. But they thought, well, this is going to be a lot of fun. We're going to meet all these fantastic, upper-class, rich dykes who are going to spend money buying stocks and bonds through us. Surprise! We came in our usual attire. I mean, you know, some of us a little butcher than others, and some of us a little dressed up. A little dressed up would be a t-shirt maybe with some glitter on it and, you know, shoes on our feet. And they didn't come down. Remember, they didn't come downstairs for a long time. We couldn't imagine what they were doing. I mean, look, meantime, we went ahead. Connie Murray was doing hot dogs and turkey burgers and all of that. And and everybody had their jobs to do. Somebody, Geneva had us all dressed up in Victorian clothes with a swing there and get your picture taken on the swing and with your girlfriend. And I mean, we had all kinds of ways that we were gonna raise money. Finally, Charlene and Ms. Nameless came downstairs and they were wearing little Takami, you can't believe it, little bustiers. This is way ahead of their time. Little bustiers with much cleavage and little tight, I couldn't even call them shorts. What's shorter than shorts? Thongs? And they came down made up and coiffed, and we all just stood there amazed. You know, this is not endemic to the North Fork lesbian community, to say the least. So we had this wonder. Jan was the auctioneer. We have pictures to prove it. And we raised a lot of money. I have no idea.
A little over $6,000.
Well, $6,000. That was a bloody fortune.
Yeah,
I mean,
it
really was. It gave us a real start. And we had a marvelous time. I mean, we didn't even care about the green flies and the black flies and the mosquitoes. But we just had a wonderful, wonderful time. And then the board knew that it was something we had to do. We just had to do every year, without benefit of Charlene and whoever. And we did do it every year from that time.
Mm-hmm.
And we did it at Marianne Wiles, which was fabulous, for 2 years. Claudia Slasik was our chef supreme, and we had these fabulous meals. Everybody just started coming. I mean, it was the event, the closing event of the summer, and also a real celebration. And we had our own musicians, our own band, Helen Hook and her Femmes, and we danced, and we just had a wonderful time, and the big bidders came in to make sure that we raised lots of money. We got wonderful donations, and art and services and dinners and kayak tours, and I mean every imaginable thing. And every year it changes, and every year it got
Let me interrupt you just for a minute. I mentioned just before you came here that one of the most enjoyable evenings I ever spent was right here in this house when you and Patsy, you had offered, what was it?
We offered to do Rogers and Field, a dress-up night of entertainment of popular music. Patsy was the pianist, I was the chanteuse. And Takami made this fantastic, I can still taste it, spread of Japanese and Asian delicacies. And
yeah, but wait a minute, Takami bought you.
Oh, she did buy
us.
She doesn't know, but she bought me for life. She thought it was just for that evening, but she bought us for life. We're waiting for a return engagement. While I'm still viable to come. Anyway, it was great fun. Patsy wore a tuxedo, and I wore a gown, as I recall, or a sequin top and torn jeans probably on the bottom, God knows. But we had a wonderful time. It was an invited group, and it was the kind of event, very creative, and that just grabbed people.
Yeah.
I mean, just some of the other events.
Yeah,
no.
Let's just recall a few of the auction items. One of the things I remember that went for a huge price was a kayak lesson by Diane Bratcher.
Yes.
Yeah. What were some of the other things? It was.
Well, of course, there was
auction.
Some wonderful art. I mean,
art.
Every year, Pucky, who gives us a
Tommy. Beautiful wood construction.
Dorothy Abbott has given sculpture. Mm-hmm. We've gotten paintings from, you know, we have a marvelous community of artists, and they've been very generous. Patsy has given recorder lessons and piano lessons. I've given voice lessons, all of which get bought in the auction, and then nobody ever shows up for them.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's hard to commit yourself to lessons. opera tickets, we've switched to opera tickets last year. Oh, what the best was one year, Diane and Marianne offered tickets to a Yankee game, preceded by a tour of art galleries in Soho.
Chelsea.
In Chelsea. And dinner at Yankee Stadium. And Patsy and I, all of that, Patsy and I said, I don't care how much this is going to cost. The sky's the limit. We're getting that. And we did. And it was, you know, it brought in some good money. And we had one of the best evenings of our lives. The highlight of which was Diane Bratcher said, come on, you have to move. You have to go over here. Come over here with me. Come over here with me. And we didn't know what she wanted, but she was shoveling us along. And on the way, Marianne and I saw a ladies' room. Never pass a ladies' room when you're over 65. So Marianne and I are in the ladies' room. We hear this voice, Marianne, Lucy, get out of there! It's time, it's 2 minutes to nine, or whatever. And then we end up down where the club seats were. And Diane places us. She tries to bribe a guard to let us stand there. And of course, we had no idea whatsoever what was going on. And suddenly, on the screen, you know, the screen that they show the scores and flashes, happy anniversary, congratulations, Rogers and Field.
Oh.
Patsy Rogers, you see, it keeps flashing, coming back. She had arranged for this to be flashed on the board as just for wonderful. Our pleasure and as a way of congratulating us. And we have pictures of it, and it was just a wonderful moment. Those are the kind of things that women from our community have planned for this auction, and long may it wave, because there's a silent auction too. I mean, not everybody has to or can or wants to get into the big bucks area, so there's a wonderful silent auction, and people make terrific contributions. So you just sign up for what you think you can manage, and sometimes you get it.
Yeah.
But the other part of the auction is really hot. It's really hot. Mm-hmm. And then there comes the dance, and people have just a wonderful time. I was hoping that live music would continue for every auction benefit, because we're so lucky to have our own women musicians. But I gather the current board has decided to have a DJ and canned music, and I'm very sad about that. I've made my opinion known, but to no avail. I mean, it's the way it's going to be. Well, change. That's what happens. You get a new board, you get change. Get a new president, please, goddess. Maybe we get change. Yeah. I'm talking for posterity. I'm talking about George W. Bush Jr.
Oh, okay, that kind of new president. Okay.
Yes, that new president. I'm content with whatever president comes to Norfolk, because it's from our community, chosen by us.
Yeah.
Certainly somebody with different ideas, different vision, and that's fine.
Yeah.
And I don't expect to agree with everything. How could it be possibly the way I want things all the time?
Well, but you did get one thing that you wanted, which was the coming out as an organization. Talk about that.
Well, this was a really hard thing to do. Number one, I have to say that Jan Swanson, whom we all love dearly, was very much against the organization coming out. And the more out we became, the less she liked it. That was her way of thinking. Some of us had another way of thinking. But one thing about Jan, even when she had a very strong, firm idea of what she wanted, when it came down to the vote, whichever way the vote came, she supported it. She was never underhanded. She never was bitter. She never did any of that. But she was feisty and forceful, and really was not for us coming out. I, on the other hand, was very much for us coming out, because I felt that was part of our mission, that was part of our goal, to establish ourselves as a lesbian organization, a presence. Hey, we can even go to Toronto and get married. That's not a proposal, but times are changing, and times were changing then. And in our little microcosm of the world, our little lesbian microcosm out here, we were trying to effect change. The very idea of us being the organization that we were was an enormous political and social change. And I felt that the next step was always to establish ourselves for who and what we are, and that that would help us being an education force, a cultural force, a societal force, and a political force. And I think that that has happened. We voted, we talked.
We were not an out organization from 1992 to when did the change occur?
Well,
it took a number of years.
It certainly took a number of years. It happened after Jan resigned from the board. She was ill and really couldn't give any energy.
1999.
I never know dates. Yeah. But we talked a lot. We talked out in the community. We had a newsletter. We tried to find out how people felt. We talked to our partners. We talked to our friends. But in the end, it was up to us to decide. And we did decide to come out. And I feel that that's one of the most important things that we did, because it changed the direction of what we were able to do. As you, if you look at the organization now, you can see there's a gay pride dance that's open to the community. There are announcements in the newspapers. The churches and other religious organizations know about us. I think there's been some work in the schools, some materials made available.
But the Suffolk Times piece last year,
yes,
on the inside of the first page, was a whole write-up.
That's right. Anne McKay is pointing out that our local newspaper did a big write-up, and I think a very fair write-up. It was news,
it was informative, yeah.
And what happened? There wasn't a great explosion or implosion. I mean, the community accepted us, and that's the way, when I say microcosm, that's the way it has to be in the universe. That we are, after all, a group of people with a lifestyle that is ours to choose and to carry on in a loving and positive way. And once we get absorbed into a community and are active in that community as a presence, I think a lot of the problems that we thought we would have to deal with have simply evaporated.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean the problems are gone, and it doesn't mean that there are people who feel very differently. But it's a step, a positive step, I think.
We just last night we had the third annual Gay Pride Dance out here.
How did it go?
I think it was very successful. I think there were maybe close to 200 people. There were a lot of men. You know, about one third
wonderful
men, maybe. And
yeah.
But the reason that I bring that up is because it was the third annual. This is the third year. So it's only been that long that we felt free to be out.
That's right.
Yeah. And and there was a lot. Do you want to talk about the sort of the internal struggle and the kind of discussions that we were having?
Well, I haven't been on the board for several years now, and I imagine that discussions go on. But when we came out, correct me if I'm wrong, Marianne, we weren't planning events yet, inclusive events. We were still dealing with bylaws and dealing with our usual events.
The brochure was what the main point. Did it have the word lesbian in it?
It did.
Right.
And that was a big step.
That was published in October of 99.
Yeah, that came with our coming out. Mm-hmm. There's a Suffolk Times now. But I think that the movement forward in the more inclusive events. I remember we had a number of committees that came out of a meeting at Nora's house. Mm-hmm. Remember that big mm-hmm. meeting at Nora's yeah. house? And we had a lot of women there, and they signed up, or they made recommendations for what they thought that Norfolk Women for Women Fund should do. And two main committee ideas came out of it. One was to have an education committee for the community that would plan events, educational events for the committee. And the other one was a cultural committee to plan cultural events. I remember Marianne fighting fiercely at a board meeting saying that some people challenged the idea of cultural events, saying, you know, that wasn't a health thing, and Marianne saying, it is, it's for the well-being, the mental and physical well-being of lesbians, that they have to have some of the events that are not strictly educational, and I was very supportive of that, and we did do it. So we had many events that started to include some gay men, I mean, like the literally lesbian, mm-hmm. where we had some readings and play, some parts of play and poetry.
Oh, you got such flack for that.
Uh-huh.
I remember that. It was a wonderful event. But you used the word lesbian.
I did.
In a flyer that was announcing the event. What was it again?
Literally lesbian. And we invited some of the writers in our community to prepare and to offer parts of works. I remember Melissa...
No, Melanie.
Melanie Mitzner. Yeah, she was writing a novel then. She mm-hmm. read part of her novel. Nancy Dean mm-hmm. did part of a play or an act. Mm-hmm. I remember Skip Waxberger acting yeah. in it. There was some poetry reading. Do you remember it, Anne? It was a good event. But there were also events with lawyers, physicians, people in healthcare. We had a big variety of events.
Yeah, but go back to the flyer, which was
the flyer
used the word.
Am I still here alive? I thought I was going to get murdered for that one. Yeah,
the flyer used the word lesbian. It was literally lesbian was the name of it.
Yes,
literally lesbian. Yeah.
If we did it today, nobody would raise a hackle.
Yeah.
But at that time, it was a big deal.
Yeah, it was in the middle 90s.
The only way you make things, you stir the pot, is you have to be willing to get into trouble. And I've been in trouble all my life, so it's nothing new.
Yeah.
And the names in the newsletter.
Oh,
we
yeah.
You have to clear all the names in
yes,
the newsletter, photographs in the newsletter.
That's right. Every now and then we'd falter and somebody's name or picture would come in without us getting permission first. That may still be the case. They may still be checking out on, yeah, and that's probably the right thing to do, to clear it with people. But, I mean, you know, the fact that there's a dance where whole communities can come, including the straight community. Absolutely.
Yeah.
The first gay pride dance, I remember there were. We made sure that we had friends there.
Yeah.
And it was a terrific mix. I didn't go last night because, given the choice of a good piano recital and the dance, because my feet hurt all the time now, I went to the piano recital because I could sit down. But I would have been better off at the dance, you know. The seats were so uncomfortable.
Oh, really?
Greenport High School. But yeah. I'm glad to hear it was a success.
Yeah.
It's good. And that's a fundraiser. Everything is to raise funds, even if it's a little. Except for the little seminars that we hold. I think the committee, what's that, HAE, Health Advocacy and
Education. Well, you started something called the Cultural...
CEA, you were on that committee.
Yeah, that's right.
Cultural event. Well, it started out with Talent Night, remember? Jenny Goddard did
Talent Night. Yeah.
And that was a huge success, and that's been open to the whole community, if they dare to come, if they have the courage to come. But we've had that now for every year for how long? Long time.
Six or seven years.
And it's changed a bit. There was an art exhibit along with it at Pocatuck Hall. There was a dance or a party that followed the talent or the non-talent, as the case may be. Yeah. But it's a lot of fun, and it takes a lot of bravery, a lot of courage for people to donate themselves that way, stand up there and often make little
make a fool of yourself. Fools. That's what Ginny said to me. We need people who are willing to make fools of themselves.
Well, we've all made fools of ourselves.
Yeah.
Let's see, Denise was Carmen Miranda once.
Yeah.
With fruit on her head.
Yeah.
Wax fruit. And you did something wild.
Oh,
funny.
Yeah.
What did you do?
I was a diva. I was that. I sent. I mean, I.
Oh yeah, I got you all gussied up to be the diva.
Yeah.
Played recording, and you were. And I remember Myrna Nachman and I once did Rossini's the Cat with recorder with Toot Sweet, the recorder lesbian recorder quartet.
Right.
How many organizations have Toot Sweet Toot Sweet playing recorder with two? Really, I mean Myrna Nachman is a fabulous musician, and I'm not so bad myself. And there we were. Doing the wearing tails and ears, or you know.
You gotta stop here because you gotta change tape.
Oh, okay.
So, I mean, it was fun.
That was fun.